Scientists now say we are living through the sixth mass extinction, the sixth time a huge number of the Earth's animals and plants have died in short order. In the last mass extinction, it is believed an asteroid impact wiped out the dinosaurs and three quarters of all other species. But this time, it is mostly humans to blame. And in a stunning new report, scientists have put numbers to the crisis. One third of the nearly 30,000 land vertebrates studied are experiencing, quote, considerable population declines. There are just 7,000 cheetahs left, one example, down from 100,000 at the beginning of the 20th century. There were nearly a million elephants in 1900. In just 20 years, they could be completely extinct. Some of that is poaching, but territory loss and climate change are thought to be main causes for these extinctions. Elizabeth Kolbert travelled the world to write a definitive account of the sixth extinction. She joins me now via Skype from Massachusetts. And thanks for doing so. Five previous mass extinctions, now the evidence is the sixth is underway. It may seem an obvious question, but what would such an extinction of these animals mean for humanity, for the planet?
Well, this is the great, you know, sort of unanswered question, and that is why I think scientists are trying really to draw attention to this issue in when we're, you know, obviously still the vast number of species on Earth still have are still around, I'm happy to say, but you really need to arrest this slide, because if you, the possibility of what people call a sort of cascade of effects where, you know, one species, it goes into decline, knocks out another, and whole ecosystems start to unravel. And that could obviously have big impacts on people, because at the end of the day, you know, everything we eat, all the fish that we fish out of the oceans, all of these depend, all of these are part of a natural world that we, you know, sort of control, but do not entirely control at this point.
Yeah, a codependency in many ways. I mean, I saw you write that in essence, a technologically advanced society, ours obviously, is choosing to destroy itself. What then are the primary choices being made that are causing this?
Well, when I wrote that line, it was primarily referring to climate change, that we've been warned over and over and over again, and now we are seeing very, very clear signs all over the world, everywhere you look, that the climate is changing and changing very rapidly and moving out of the space in which humans, I should point out, humans are a pretty young species. We've only been around for maybe 200,000 or 300,000 years. We are moving the climate out of the climate regime in which humans evolved, and that's obviously a pretty dangerous thing to do.
We're looking at a video there of a giraffe, and they're threatened as well. You know, scientists talk a lot about a bias for lovable animals, and there's a lovable one, the giraffe. But you've also written a lot about the Panamanian golden frog, which is in danger. There's a pangolin, which we've reported on here on CNN. There's some species of bats as well. Explain to people why they should care about those perhaps less than cuddly creatures.
Well, as I said, I mean, you know, the message of ecology, of the science of ecology, has always been everything is connected, and it's connected in ways that we don't always understand, often until it's too late. But we are intimately connected. Our source of, as I said, our source of all of our food, all of our oxygen, all of this comes from life itself. And to start pulling at the threads of these ecosystems, which and not knowing, you know, how far you can tug before they start to unravel, that's a very risky strategy. So even if you think, you know, that pangolin, I'm not sure, you know, it's really affecting my daily life, I didn't even know the pangolin existed, it's still probably true, 6 degrees of separation, as it were, that you and that pangolin are connected in some pretty important ways.
I guess the question is, can it be turned around? I imagine it can, but when is too late?
Well, I don't think there's ever a moment where we get to say it's just too late. There's obviously, in all of these issues, all of the forces that are producing this mass extinction event, and there are unfortunately many of them. Climate change is one, habitat loss is another, poaching is a third, invasive species, so species we move around the world that have, you know, big effects on other species. All of these are contributing to this extinction event. So there's not, you know, sort of one thing we have to do. There are many things we have to do, but and on almost all of these fronts, We know very significant steps to take, and we need to take them. And I will use the example of climate change. We need to dramatically reduce our carbon emissions. We actually know how to do it. We just haven't been doing it.
It's a matter of will, isn't it? And to that point, you know, it's interesting as this unfolds, you have here in the US a massive rollback of environmental protections under the Trump administration, so-called deregulation, if you like. But a lot of that is going unnoticed because of the waves of coverage of Russia and other various daily controversies. But meanwhile, it really is a stunning number of regulations being removed. How do you react to that? What's the impact?
Well, I think that's very frightening, and it's exactly the opposite of what we need to be doing. We need to be looking at these issues in a very serious, sober-minded way, being driven by, you know, what we know, and being humbled by what we don't know. And the Trump administration is taking the exact opposite tack, sort of blundering in there, ignoring the science. Literally, you can go on the website of agencies like the EPA these days, and the science has been removed. So it's a very, very disheartening development, and I think the consequences will play out, you know, for all intents and purposes, potentially forever. Now, the one caveat here and the one bit of good news is at every step of the way, he's going to be challenged in court. And we have yet to see exactly how that's going to play out.
Mm. You know, one of our colleagues, David McKenzie, reported just recently on moving a whole bunch of elephants from one part of Africa to another. Is that sort of thing substantial enough? Is that enough? Or is it nibbling around the edges? Or does it all count?
Well, there's a lot of, you know, questions nowadays, because there are so many species in trouble. Where do you put your resources? What do you do? Elephants are obviously a hugely, you know, what are called charismatic megafauna. They're a species that gets a lot of attention, and rightly so. They're magnificent animals. They're very slow to reproduce. So when you are killing them off faster than they can reproduce, which is exactly what we're doing right now, they are, as you suggested earlier, headed toward oblivion. And I think most people would agree anything you can do to save elephants is really worth doing at this point. But it does raise bigger questions, because there are so many species out there, as you say, so many frogs and toads and even at this point insects that are endangered, so many that we don't even know about yet. Where do you put your resources? And these are all questions that are not going away, I can assure you.
The final lesson being, though, that things can be done and should be done if there is a will for them to be done. Elizabeth Kolbert, thanks so much.
Oh, thanks for having me.